Yes, sir.
As we all know, due to this global pandemic, it's very difficult for everyone to go to the field and have such experience. A huge thank you to Mohit, sir. Here I will be briefing about the event. In this session, we will discuss bedding foliation in the field, differentiate between primary and secondary structure, deep end strike of the bedding joints and fault planes, how to identify joint sets, how to measure slope dip direction and slope angle, how to identify conglomerate and diamicet in the field. For the easy and smooth going of the session, all mic will be kept on the mute except the mic of presenter. If you have any doubt, please raise your hand and we will help you to solve your query by unmuting you. Now, without further delay, I would like to pass on to the Mohit sir. Over to you, Mohit sir.
Hello. Good morning from Higher Himalaya. Right now, I'm sitting in Higher Himalaya in Uttarakhand state. And I think this is the luckiest day because before this event, I was planning to conduct this field work nearby Dehradun. But due to some urgent work for Uttarakhand Jal Vidyut Nigam Limited, I switched to this field work in Higher Himalaya. So basically, we are sitting right now at the bank of river Mandakini. This is the tributary of mighty river Ganga. So this is here, we will discuss about the different lithology. You can see the exposure here at the right bank of this river. So we have alternate bandings of the schistose gneiss and the amphibolite intrusions. Except this, we have lots of structures like shear sense indicators, faulting, and some shear sense indicator in the form of the sigmoidal veins and the rotated porphyroclast, as well as the asymmetrical folding also. So we can use asymmetrical folding as a shear sense indicator to identify the some regional structures like MBT, MCT, main boundary thrust, main central thrust, or Vakrata thrust, or STDS, Southern Tibetan Detachment System. So not going to delay, let me first explain you how to identify the foliation in the metamorphic rock. Basically, the origin of this rock is igneous, because we are in Higher Himalaya, and as you know, Higher Himalaya composed by crystalline rock. So you can see the crystalline rock here. Okay, so in crystalline rock, when the pressure and temperature comes due to this Himalayan orogeny, all the minerals align in a particular direction due to the force. So these alignment of the minerals form the foliation. So we will see here, as you can see here, you can see this is a, here we can see some minerals align in a particular direction. Okay, just a minute, let me fix this. Okay.
I think sir has just left. Wait for me.
For the disconnection. Okay.
Yes,
okay. You can see the mineral alignment in a particular direction. So these mineral alignment, and you can see some small grains of the garnet also. Garnet grains are present here. You can see here, all the grains are aligned in a particular direction. So this is the way how we can identify the foliation planes. So basically, this is the foliation plane, and this is a schistose gneiss. So you can see the schist band, means mica rich bands here. So these bands show the schistosity. If you try to exfoliate from here, they will split easily, because the tendency of the mica is particularly to split in the parts, because the the form of the mica mineral is the platyform, and they can split very easily. So this shows a cystose structure, and gneiss, basically gneiss is composed by two type of structure. One is cystose structure, another one is the granulose structure. So granulose bands, these are very thin bands. You can see here, these are the granulose bands here. So these are granulose bands composed by quartz and feldspar, and these are the cystose bands, and here composed by mica, basically biotite and the muscovite. So based on these structure, we can identify this is the cystose gneiss, because the composition of the cystose bands over this exposure is high or more than the granulose bands. That's why this is known as cystose gneiss. Otherwise, you can say this is a gneiss, but the dominancy of the mica mineral is more than the these feldspathic bands in the form of the granulose band. That's why this is known as the cystose bands. Okay, so I think this one is the clear. Now we can move towards the this direction. So you can see here we have a very different color rock that is greenish in color here in this direction, and we have light in color rock here at the right side. So this is the intrusion, and this is basically this is the means contact of this greenish color rock and the whitish color rock. So basically this is a intrusion here that form after the formation of this cystose host rock. We have two types of intrusion. One is concordant intrusion, another one is the discordant intrusion. So basically you can see this intrusion is parallel to the foliation. This is the foliation, and this is intruded parallel to the foliation. So this one is the concordant, not discordant. So we can say this one is the sill formation. You have studied in your basic geology, sill, dike, etc. So this is amphibole. So this is different lithology. Let's see, this is the greenish color, greenish in color due to the presence of the amphibolite minerals. Due to amphibolite minerals, we have lots of intrusion of the quartz also in the host rock, because during the intrusion we have some extensional extensional resin that form in this area, and due to that extension we have lots of intrusion in the form of the amphibolite and in the form of the quartz veins and quartz budins. Okay, then here you can see this gneiss is also deformed. This amphibolite is also deformed. Here you can see the thin minerals of the amphibolite is also align in a particular direction. That's due to the deformation. So foliation is also developed in the amphibolite. Okay, so we can say this is the amphibolite, and the foliation plane, this is foliation, foliation plane is also parallel to the this system. So now here we can we'll try to calculate the dip and strike over this surface. First of all, how we can can take the idea where is the dip direction of the bed. So first of all, we have to see whole the exposure. So, but in some cases, what happens, some master joints can control the slope. As you can see here, slope is towards me. I'm holding the camera. So slope is towards me, but the foliation direction is towards parallel to my hand or parallel to my palm. So here, slope is like this. So slope is controlled by the joints. So sometime what happened, we have some arbitrary idea, or we can take the wrong direction of the foliation after seeing the area. So here slope is controlled by the master joint, that is other than the foliation joint. So foliation direction is towards this direction, or we can identify the foliation with the help of the alignment of the minerals. You have to keep this thing in your mind. Without seeing the minerals alignment, we can't identify the foliation direction properly. So first of all, what we have to do, we have to pour some dry soil over the inclined plane. This is the foliation plane, and we have identified due to the alignment of the minerals. So we have to pour some dry soil. So you can see over this surface, this dry soil is following this path. It's due to the gravity. So this gravity direction is giving us a arbitrary idea. That means the dipping direction is towards somewhere here. Okay, this one is clear. Now this is the means apparent deep direction. This is not true deep direction. So true deep direction, we always collect the data of the true deep direction from the field. So we have to collect the true deep data from the field in the case of the surface mapping. Okay, so we have to means collect this data, and we can use some different instrument like a Brenton compass and the clinometer. So I have Brenton compass here, and we can use this Brenton compass to calculate the deep end strike. So I have Brenton compass. This is Brenton compass. So similar Brenton compass you have in your institution also, and you have seen this Brenton compass in your institution. So here we have one taper point. So in our classes, we always suggest the student you have to keep this taper or pointed point towards the towards our objective. And here our objective is the deep direction of the foliation plane. So here we have a needle that is known as the magnetic needle, and we have a mirror here also. So you can use this mirror also to save in the field if you are posted in remote area. That's jokes apart. But this mirror is basically used to collect the fore bearing and the back bearing of any object that is very far to us. So what we have to do, we have to align this Brenton compass towards our object, and we have to see, we have to align our object to this means pointing portion and this line, black line. So this is the use of that mirror to calculate the direction of any object that is very far now. In the Brenton compass, one scale is that is outer scale 0 to 36 degrees. You can see here. So this is 0 to 36 degrees, 90 degrees percentage. Sextant method is basically, we have studied in physics. So sextant method is basically used to calculate the distance of any object based on the angles. So if we know the angle and we know the horizontal distance of any two marked points, then we can calculate the exact distance from observer to object. So that scale used for the sextant method. Now, here one more important thing. You can see this plane is always perpendicular to this plane. All the plane or all the edges of the Brenton compass is always perpendicular to each other. What is the use of these planes? I'll explain later. Now, this Brenton compass is different from your institution Brenton compass, because this Brenton compass have more scale like here. So this scale is basically this side also and this side also. This scale is basically used to calculate the deep amount directly for the engineering geological purpose. And this scale give the fast speed to calculate the deep and deep direction and deep amount of any plane. So if you have to collect hundreds of data, thousands of data in a day, then this such type of Brenton compass is very usable. Now we have two air bubble, or here one is cylindrical bubble and another one is circular bubble. So cylindrical bubble is basically used to bring this as a horizontal line. So this is the use of the cylindrical bubble. Then we have a circular bubble. If you put the circular bubble in the center, it means the base of the Brenton compass in the horizontal scale. What is the application of the base to bring the base in the horizontal manner? Why? Because due to this horizontalness, this magnetic needle can move freely in the dial. So basically, if we move our Brunton compass, the dial is always rotated. Magnetic needle is always means stagnant. So if we move the Brunton compass, magnetic needle never rotate. Dial is always rotated. Then how to calculate the deep strike of the inclined strata? Here I am using the word strata or object because we can calculate the deep end strike of any planar feature in the field. So here, come here. I will show it another plane. So we have to walk here. So please don't mind, because in the field we have to walk several kilometers in a day to collect the useful data for our study. So here we have some planar features. These planes are very useful to teach the students. So basically, again we apply the same manner here. We have to see the alignment of the minerals. So this is the alignment of the mineral you can see in a particular direction. So this plane is the foliation plane. So first of all, what we have to do in the Brunton compass, we have to bring all the zero at the center. You can rotate this scale from the backside of the Brunton compass. So we have to rotate this and we have to bring all the scale in the horizontal line. So this is 0-0 method. This method is known as the 0-0 method. So first of all, I want to tell you what is the strike. So strike is an imaginary line on a inclined plane. Strike is an imaginary horizontal line on an inclined plane that show the maximum extension. Because why I am saying show the maximum extension? As you see this plane here, this is the horizontal line over here, and this one is also a horizontal line over here. But this is not the maximum extension of the plane. This is the maximum extension of the plane. So we have to put the strike over the maximum extension of the plane. So don't use this one, because this is the thickness. Okay, this is the maximum extension. So what we have to do after bring all the scale 0-0, we have to put our Brunton compass over the plane. And what we have to do, we have to try cylindrical bevel in the center. So you can see I am rotating this Brunton compass and try to bring the cylindrical bevel in the center. So this is the center point. So here, what is the use of this to bring this cylindrical bevel in the center? It marks the horizontal line over the inclined plane. So parallel to this plane of the Brunton compass, here, this is the trace of the strike over this inclined plane. Now, what is the next step? I'll put my Brunton compass parallel to this line and try to bring the circular bubble in the center. So you can see, this is the circular bubble in the center. And now we can read any edge of the magnetic needle. As you can see, this south portion is at 315 and north portion at 145. So strike has two directions. You can read anyone. Okay, so this is the strike. So this is our strike, 315 degree. Now, what we have to do, we know this is a strike here and show the maximum extension. And after pouring the dry soil or water over surface, this one is rolling towards the gravity. So we have to put our Brunton compass, the pointed portion, towards the dip direction or towards the rolling direction like this. Here, this plane is perpendicular to this. This plane is parallel to the strike, and this plane of the Brunton compass is perpendicular to the dip direction. So when we put over the marked line like this and bring the circular bubble in the center, like this. So this is our dip direction. This is 0.055. So 0.055 is our dip direction and 145 over strike. Okay, now we have to calculate the angle of the inclination. So this Brunton compass is formed in the different manner. I can collect the data like this also. when I am collecting the dip direction data, so I can read this scale at the side. So side scale, so this is almost 38 degrees. This is 38 degrees. So it's give the direct measurement of the inclination also. If you have ordinary Brunton compass, then no need to worry. What you have to do, you have to keep the Brunton compass perpendicular to the mark strike line, and you have to rotate the cylindrical bevel from the backside of the Brunton compass up to that point when the cylindrical bevel comes in the center. So now this is the center point, and now we have to read this 60 to 60 scale zero over the 90 to 90 scale. So the 0 degree variation can, because that's depend on the instrument to instrument and depends on man to man also. That's why we have collect lots of data to determine the dip and strike of any particular foliation in a particular region. Okay. So this is the method of the how to collect the dip and strike of data over the foliation plane. So if you have any question up to this point, then you can ask. Otherwise, we'll move further. If anybody have any question regarding dip and strike of foliation, then he or she can ask.
If you have any question, you can raise your hand. We will allow to unmute yourself.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, I have a doubt that today's world, we have so many advanced technologies and we have so many new things coming up in terms of technology. So why are we still using the Brunton as it is made since so many years? Is there any other method or other technology developed for Brunton?
Yeah, there is so many software you can download in your phone also. And one software is stereographic projection that is introduced by the Apple. If you click the photograph of any slope, it can even automatically plot the stereographic projection of the discontinuity, like joint, shear zone, and fractures also. But the advantage of the Brunton compass is, one advantage is, you have fully control. You can identify the joint because software identify any fracture, whether that is a set or whether that is a random fracture. It can analyze that also. Here, if you use the Brunton compass, you can collect the exact data, what joint you should, you want to analyze, you can collect that data also. Yes, there is one more software in the for the phones. If you put your phone on the inclined plane, it will automatically calculate the dip amount and dip direction also. But the disadvantage of that software, you can't measure the inclination of any curvy features, you can't calculate the plunge and plunge direction of the fold with the help of that software. That is the disadvantage of that software. Okay, and sometime what happen if suppose that you are doing work in underground, then in that portion that phone is very typical and very difficult to use, because there is network problem in the tunnels and underground excavations, so you can't use there. And even sometime what happen, they give some error also. You can't minimize that error also. And sometimes what happens, there is lots of ingression of the water, lots of seepage in underground structure. So you can't use your phone for such type of situations. So I think that is the advantage of the Brunton compass against these softwares.
Absolutely, sir. So whatever happens, Brunton is going to always get the advantage over other technologies.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome. Any other question?
Test, you can ask.
Hello, sir. Good morning, sir.
Yeah. Good morning, Suraj.
Sir, like you, as you have said that measuring the direction of pollution plane, we have to measure the direction of mineral. But what if that mineral have different sets of planes? Like which direction then we should go with? What direction
different
we should look
at? Sets of planes.
Like mineral have different sets of planes. Like what? How do we decide? How do we determine the direction of that mineral plane? Which plane we should go after?
Okay, here is one basic theory about the stress and strain. When we put the stress over a mineral, it will always elongate towards the minimum stress direction. Okay, if you try to compress from the vertically, it will elongate perpendicular to the compressing direction. So what happened? It will elongate perpendicular to the stress direction. So you have to see the longest axis of the mineral. So longest axis of the mineral is always the maximum deformation direction, or you can say the strain direction. So you have to see the C axis of that particular mineral.
Okay, so means that strain or that stress will cause a elongation along that axis, and that's
exactly
how we will look. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
So much, sir.
Anyone have another question? Yes, sir, you can carry.
Okay, now we'll move towards the some different data, that is joint set. So if we see this exposure, so you can see there is lots of fracture at this outcrop. So some joints are means like sister and brother. Okay, they are occurring in a particular set, in a particular direction, they are dipping in a particular direction, and they have a particular spacing also. So these such type of joints known as the joint set. If suppose that you can see here, we have a set here also. This one is the joint here, then same parallel joint we have here. Okay, then same parallel joint we have here. So these joints are have same attitude. They are dipping towards this direction, towards your left, towards your screen left. So they are dipping towards this direction, and they are occurring in a particular orientation. They are have a definite spacing. If you measure the spacing, perpendicular distance from one joint to another joint, they have a definite spacing. Definite spacing, and that is varies from 20 to 40 centimeter. So this is a set. Okay, then when we see this surface from this direction, so we have another set. If you see this fracture here, okay, are you following me? Are you able to see this stick? Okay, so
yes,
this
sorry.
Is another fracture, and we have another fracture here also. Then we have another fracture here also. So this is a different set again. So this is second set of the joint. Okay. So this is a set of the joint. If we talk about the random joint, then we have another set here also. You can see we have a joint here that is parallel to that I have described previously, this one. So this is a second set again. Okay. Come here, I'll show you some random joint also. Yes. You can see a fracture here. Okay. So this is different from any other fracture those are present at this outcrop. So this there is no any group member of that resemble to this fracture. So basically this is a random fracture. So you can see this is a joint or fracture. But here you can see these are these joints are means occurring in a regular manner. They have a definite orientation also. Okay, they have definite spacing. This joint also and this joint also. Okay, they have definite spacing also. So these are the sets. So generally in the rocks in Himalaya as well as in different orogeny of the Indian continent and other continents also, we can identify 3 to 4 sets of the joints. More than 4 sets, it's very difficult to identify the sets in the field. Sometimes some very wise person or very genius person can identify 5 sets also, but that is very, very difficult. But generally, suppose that somebody asks you question, how many sets you can get in the rocks? How many sets of joints you can get in the rocks? So answer is 3 to 4 sets. Okay, but more than 4 sets, it's very, very difficult to identify the 5 sets or 6 sets. But some people, those are very means expert in the field or very genius in nature or in their work, they can identify 5 sets and even 6 sets also. But 5 sets and 6 sets always occur at a tectonic structure, or we can say at a thrust nearby thrust plane, or we can say nearby a damage zone like main central thrust, main boundary thrust, or great boundary fault in other region. So basically 5 to 6 sets always occurred in a nearby damage zone or thrust zone or very large scale fault zone or regional structure, nearby regional structure. So how to collect here? We have a question, how to collect the data of the joints. So method is same. Here you can see this is the joint plane and this is the foliation plane. I have explained how to collect the dip and strike of the foliation plane in the field. Here we have a joint. So this is almost vertical. Same process we have to apply for this plane also. So first of all, what I have to do, I have to bring this Brunton compass at 0-0 level. Then again put my Brunton compass from the backside over this plane and bring the cylindrical bevel at the center point. Okay, so this is the center point of the cylindrical bevel. So that means this is the trace of the horizontal line over this inclined plane like this. So this is the trace of the horizontal line over this inclined plane. Same thing, I have to keep my Brunton compass parallel to this marked line, that is a strike, and bring the circular bubble in center. Okay, so again we have to read any point of this magnetic needle. You can read north point and the south point also. This is 095. Okay. Then again you can pour the dry soil over this plane. So gravity is means moving this dry soil towards this direction. So this is our arbitrary dip direction. So I have to put my Brunton compass perpendicular to the this marked line like this. Okay, and bring the circular bubble in center. So now you have to read the north part. Okay, because this pointing portion is towards our object and this object is our dip direction. So you have to read here north part. So this is 195. This is 195. Okay, then we have to calculate the inclination of this strata. Then again you have to put your Brunton compass perpendicular to this plane and you have to move the cylinder and this is it. So here you can see this is 54 is the dip amount of this strata. Okay, so this plane or this joint plane is dipping at high. Okay. If you have any question regarding this, similarly, we can collect other joint data also. Similarly, same thing we have to apply for all the planar feature. Planar feature like fault plane, like joint plane, like foliation plane, like parallel fault planes, axial plane of the fold also. You can apply same method everywhere to collect the dip and the strike of any planar feature, only for planar feature, not linear feature. So this is the method how to collect the dip and the strike of foliation, joint plane. Okay, now I'll show you some fault also. Okay, come here. Again, you can see the intrusion. Actually, this area is very rich from the intrusion. You can see, again, you can see, means different color of the rock. And here we have different color of the rock. We have here, again, if you go towards this direction, upstream of the Mandakini River, then we have variation in the lithology. Here, you can see this band. This band is basically pure cyst. And cyst is, this is not a biotite cyst, this is muscovite cyst. You can see here. You can take the close view here. So this is a muscovite cyst. So this is a band of the muscovite cyst here, okay? So there is lots of, now I'll show you some fault features. How to identify the fault in the field. Okay, so this is the outcrop scale fault. If you see here, oh, okay. Are you able to see this line?
Yes, sir.
So if you trace this line, this is means if you see this one, this is some oxidized also, some weathered point also. So basically these are some weak zone at this outcrop. If you trace this line, here we have some markers. To identify the fault in the, we have some criteria. How to identify the fault in the field. One criteria that is very basic criteria and everybody have studied in their textbook, that is the marker. Hum sab logon ne, we have made some blocks diagram in our graduation level and post-graduation level, and we always saw a dark line that is displaced against the another dark line. That is known as the marker. Here we have a marker. If you trace this dark line here, from here to here, you can see the continuity. This one is terminating against, and we trace this line, this one is displaced towards this direction. Okay, so this is a plane, this is our fault plane, and this line is displaced against this plane towards this direction. Network. Yes, again. Okay, sorry for the network problem. Actually, I am in field, that's why. Okay, so this is our marker line, and you can see this marker line is terminating along this plane. So this is our fault plane, and this marker line displaced from this point to this point. So the inclination of this marker line, you can put your cardboard here. Cardboard. So this is our fault plane. And you can see this line is displaced towards this direction. So this one is displacing towards this direction, and this is a fault plane here, and this is dipping towards this direction. So this is our hanging wall, and this is our foot wall. There is a very common criteria to identify the hanging wall and foot wall in the field. Suppose that you have to stand over this fault plane. So what will we do? We put our foot here and head here. Okay. So foot is always, when you stand over here, your foot towards this direction. So this is your foot wall and this is your hanging wall. In the case of reverse type of fault, you can apply same things and you can easily determine the foot wall and the hanging wall. So this is our fault plane dipping towards this direction, that is point towards my pointing fingers. Okay, and here this is our marker and this marker is displaced towards this direction and this is our dip direction. So this is a
Hello, sir. Actually, you are muted. Hello.
Hello, sir.
Hello, sir.
Okay. Oh, sorry. So here we are very lucky enough because we have marker here, because we can identify the fault here based on this marker lines and marker laminations or thin beds. But if suppose that we have a homogeneous lithology, like if you are taking the geological traverse in Siwalik, so Siwalik is basically composed by means you are traveling in or traversing in lower Siwalik. So lower Siwalik or middle Siwalik and upper Siwalik, also some part of upper Siwalik, composed by sandstone. That is very homogeneous. In that case, we have to use the dragging point. So here, what happened, when you see, if suppose that this is our plane, and this plane is, this block is moving towards downward side. So what happened, this block is moving towards downward side. So my block will be curved in the upper side, like this. So you can see this block is moving towards downward side. That's why this one is curving like this. So this is the curvature of the plane. So based on this, this is known as the dragging structure. So dragging structure, what happened? Dragging structure is known not always occurred in the field, because dragging is depend on the rheology of the rock here. Because these are the crystalline rock and they form in the very deeper depth of the earth. That's why we are getting dragging here. But suppose that we have sandstone or we have a quartzite. So it's very difficult to identify the dragging in the quartzite, because quartzite is very brittle in nature. So there is one more criteria that is known as the P and Y structure. Okay, so P and Y structure is also the CSS indicator. So with the help of the P and Y structure, we can identify. But we are lucky enough here, we have dragging structure. So you can see the dragging of this block is towards this direction. And the dragging of this block is the opposite direction. So that means this block is moving towards upward side. And this block is moving towards downward side. That's why we are getting opposite dragging at both the blocks. So with the help of this, we can identify this fault plane here. Okay. Similar, we have lots of small scale faulting here, like this. Here also we have another fault plane, and this one is known as the, you can see here, one plane is here, another plane is here, and this plane is merging at this point. So this one is known as the extensional faulting here. Extensional faulting at this plane. So based on the dragging, based on the markers, we can identify the fault plane. Now, how to calculate the dip and strike of the fault plane? Okay, so we have to put our cardboard here, and same method we can apply, like previously we have applied for the foliation, we have applied for the joint plane also. So we have a fault plane here. Again, we bring our Brenton compass 00 and we put it here. Then we can calculate, mark the strike, then dip direction and dip amount. So this is about the fault plane. Okay. If you have any question about this fault plane, you can ask. Otherwise, I'll move for the CSNS indicator.
Okay, anyone has any question, you can raise your hand. We'll allow to unmute. Anyone has any question? I think there is no question, sir. You can move ahead.
Okay. Okay. So here one more interesting thing. When we look after the rock type, you can see we have lots of garnet here. Okay. If you are lucky enough, you can get enough big stone and you can make your ring also. So we have lots of garnet here. So this is a garnetiferous schistosgneiss. You can see there is lots of garnet and some garnet are very big also, like this. This one. So these are the garnetiferous schistosgneiss. This one is very big garnet here. This one. This one is very big enough. Okay. So let's move towards the CSNS indicators. Yeah. Yes. Okay. So we have lots of structure. You have studied in your textbook S-type fold, Z-type fold, M-type fold. Have you studied?
Yes.
Okay, koi baat nahi. Puchte hain. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Let's come here. We have a S-type of fold here. Are you able to see this one?
Haan, sir.
Okay. So this one is visible to you. You can see this one. This one is the S-type of fold. So this is a CSNS indicator. Always remember, symmetrical fold is not a CSNS structure. Asymmetrical fold is always a CSNS indicator. So S-type of fold, Z-type of fold, M-type of fold, W-type of fold is always known as parasitic fold also. And they form due to the rheological differences. So why such type of S type of fold are forming here? So you can see we have lots of alternate bending of the mica rich bands and the feldspar rich band and even some intrusions also. That's why such type of dragging is occurring here, and dragging is controlled by the tectonic event. So basically we are sitting at the hanging wall of the MCT, main central thrust. So they are showing the thrusting events. So this is a S-type of fold. S-type of fold is always occurred at the right limb of the antiform structure or anticline structure. If the structure is synform or syncline, they always occur at the left limb of the syncline. Z-type of fold always occurred at the left limb of the anticline and at the right limb of the syncline. M-type of fold always occurred at the hinge portion of the antiform, and W structure is always occurred at the center point or at the hinge point of the synclinal structure. So if you are getting such type of structure in the field, so what type of data you have to collect? I'll explain here. Brinton compass. So first of all, you have to take the beautiful picture perpendicularly. Then what you have to do, you have to collect the dragging direction. You have to collect the dragging direction. What is the direction? This direction. Because this one is dragging towards this direction. This direction. So this is the thrusting direction. So this direction is towards northern direction. Okay. This is top to north. So you have to mark this top to north or top to south or top to east, whatever present in the field. So you have to collect this direction. This is top to north direction. top to south. Sorry, I have read wrong one. This is top to south. So this is the typical shearing direction of the Himalaya, top to south. Okay. So this is belongs to MCT. Because MCT is riding towards the southern direction. So this is top to south. So this is the dragging structure or asymmetrical fold. Except this, we have some fold also. You can see here. So these are the folded veins. So these folded veins, this is, you can apply the Ramsey classification here. The limbs are thin, hinge are very thick. Okay, so you can apply the Ramsey classification and you can identify the mechanism of the formation of such type of the folds also. Here, you don't need to collect the plunge direction data. Okay, or you want to collect, you can collect because this plunging towards parallel to your strike of the foliation here. Okay, so you can collect here, or what you can do, you can collect the foliation data, that is the axial plane data, and axial plane is dipping towards northern direction based on our previous collection of the data. Okay, now here we have some burins also. We have one burin. Okay, here also, here we have one more burin. This is quartz burin. Okay, these are asymmetrical burins. Okay, we have some beautiful burins also. You can see this one also. So here you can see this burin is asymmetrical. We have two types of burin. One is symmetrical, another one is the asymmetrical. So we use asymmetrical burinas to collect the CSS data. So you can see this burin. So what happened here, you have to see in the field. If you apply the force like this, so this formation can form, or this formation can form if you apply like this. So here is the shearing direction towards top to south. You have to collect the data like this. So this is that you have to mark the center point like this. So this one is the thinning like this and thinning like this. And the inclination of the center line is towards our top. So if you apply the force from top to south direction, it will form like this. So this is the shearing direction from top to south direction, from top to south direction. So here we can use such type of asymmetrical burinas to calculate the CSS direction. Okay, then we have some big burinas also, some inclusion also. Let me see. Yes. If you see this band here, Asis, please hold it. If you see this band, this is a patch of the amphibolite. This is a patch of the amphibolite, and this is again a burinized structure. This one is eroded from this portion. But if you follow your foliation like this, so this is a burinized structure. This is composed of the amphibolite. This is amphibolite patch, and this one is the cystosna, garnetiferous cystosna. So again, this is a burinized, and if I mark the center line of this burinized, this one is tilting towards the upward direction. So if mark the shearing direction, this one is from top to left. This is my left, this is top to left, and the direction is south. This direction is south. So again, this is a burinized structure, and we can use the fold striation in the form of the silicon sites and high-end raised structure. Okay, so we have a plane here. I don't know this one is visible to you all or not. So spin from this direction, we have some higher portion and we have some lower portion. So these are known as high ridges, like this. This is a higher portion and this is a depression portion. Then we have depression, then again high portion, then again depression. So these are known as depression and high portion or ridges portion. So these are the indicator of the fault plane. So basically, along this plane, we have a movement. If you move your hand along this plane, you feel some smoothness, or you can say this is a silicon side plane up to some extent. So if you feel this plane from bottom to top, this one is the smoothness. This is a smooth. But if you feel means move your hand from top to bottom side, this is rough. That means the upper block was moving upward direction. So how we can calculate the plunge of this plane, these linear features? So first of all, we have to mark the strike of the plane with the help of the Brenton compass here. Yes, one more thing student was asking me, what is the advantage of the Brenton compass? So with the help of your digital application, you can't measure. You have to use your Brenton compass. So this is the advantage. Again, this is the advantage of your Brenton compass over the application, or we can say recent application. First of all, you have to bring your Brenton compass 00. We have two methods. One method, you can calculate the pitch, then you can calculate the plunge direction with the help of the stereographic projection in the laboratory or at your home, or you can directly measure the pitch and plunge in the field itself. So first of all, you have to mark the dip and strike. You have to mark the strike. So this is our horizontal line over this inclined plane. So this is our strike line. Now you have to mark the measuring direction of the strike, because strike has two direction. You can read north portion and south portion. Now we have to keep this thing in our mind, which point or which end we have used to calculate the pitch and plunge of this linear feature, of these linear feature. So what you have to do, you have to bring again your Brenton compass here. So this is our northern end. So here I am reading northern end. So this 275, north 275. So I have to mark this like this. Okay. Now, the linear feature over this plane are aligning like this. So these are approximately parallel to your dip direction. So this is a up dipping thrust or up dipping fault. So up dipping fault means this is a reverse fault. So what we have to calculate the angle between strike line and this linear feature. So what is the plunge? Plunge is the angle between the linear feature and the horizontal line or horizontal plane. So this is our aim here. We have to calculate the plunge amount. So this is our plunge amount. So if you have D in the field, you can directly measure the acute angle of this between strike and the linear feature in at the field also. If you don't have D, no problem. You click the vertical photographs and bring this photograph to your laptop and mark this line, and you can calculate the angle between this linear feature. Then you can and then you have direction also. So you can calculate with the help of the stereographic projection also. So this is the method how we can use. Now, what is the plunge direction basically? So this is dipping upward side. So what you have to do, you have to measure this direction. You have to keep your Brenton compass, this portion, parallel to your linear feature. So that is your plunging direction. And you have to measure the acute angle, this one, theta one. Okay, with the help of D. If you don't have D, so don't take tension, mark the strike, mark the measuring end, bring it at your laboratory, bring it at your software, and plot over the problem. So this is how we can calculate the dip and strike of the means stariation plane, high region, and how to identify the fault plane in the field with the help of different devices. Okay. So these structures known as SC structures. So structure can form in compressional regime and can be formed in extensional regime. Compressional regime SC structures are very easy to use, but to use extensional SC structures, first of all, we have to establish whether we are in the hanging wall of the thrust or foot wall in the thrust. Extensional SC structure always occurred at the foot wall of the thrust because there is the extensional regime. In the hanging wall, there is a compressional regime, so you will get SC structure at the foot walls, hanging wall side first. If you are dealing with the normal fault, so normal the hanging wall of the normal fault is always represent the extensional regime, so you will get extensional SC structure at the foot wall of the normal. If you are traveling or if you are taking traverse at the foot wall of the normal fault, then you will get compressional SC structure at the foot wall side. So to use such type of structure, we have to know the regional geology and we have to know the proper knowledge of the area. So here, let's see the SC structures. So here, we have one plane here. This is a shear plane. Again, we have a shear plane here like this. So you can see this this sigmoidal structure. So this is a sigmoidal structure. Over this is a roof shear zone, and this is a foot, or you can say the ground shear zone. So this is bounded by two shear zones. One is here, another one is here, and you can see there is lots of sigmoidal structures. So these sigmoidal structure, when shearing happen, what happen? If suppose that this block is moving towards this direction, so it will drag this portion towards this direction, and this portion will drag towards this direction. That's why this one is tapering towards this direction or acute angle towards this direction. Or we can use, this is a shear zone, shear plane here, or fault plane here, or separation plane here. So if you measure the acute angle here, this one is measuring the acute angle. So the opposite direction of the acute angle, that is this one. So this is the shearing direction. Here also, this is the acute angle. This one is dipping towards this direction. So this is the acute angle. So the shearing direction from the bottom is towards this direction. So in such type of structure, we always use from top. So we always mark the shearing direction from the top. So this is top to left. So this is top to left. So this is the sigmoidal structure. Okay. Any other thing? Yes, we have lots of sigmoidal veins here. This one is also not veins, means rotated porphyroclast. So again, we have rotated porphyroclast here, here, and here. So this area is full of lots of rotated porphyroclast. I think this is enough. One more thing is how to calculate the angle of the slope in the field with the help of the Brenton compass. If you have any question up to this point, you can ask. If you don't have, then I'll move further.
Anyone has any question, you can raise your hand. Hello.
Okay. So you
yes, sir.
Don't
we
have
can
any
move
question.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. We can move ahead. So this is our last task. Okay. So this is our view of the slope here. Okay. So this is the trend of our slope like this. So with the help of the Brenton compass, what we can do, we have to put our Brenton compass parallel to our slope. this is our slope. Now I am putting my Brenton compass parallel to our slope here, like this. So here again, the same method we can apply, just like our measuring the dip and strike of the foliation and joint also and fault. So we can same method we can apply here also. So same, this is the dip direction, pointing direction is representing the dipping direction of the slope, and the angle of the slope is also, we can measure like the plane also, like this. So we have to put our Brenton compass parallel to our slope like this and move the cylindrical bubble from the back side to bring this cylindrical bubble in the center. So this is almost 34 degree. So this is the angle of the slope and this is the direction of the slope. So this is the method how we can or measure the dip and strike or angle of the slope in the field. Okay. Now one more thing I can add here, because I am at the right bank of this. So maybe you know this thing, but I'm just refreshing your knowledge. This is Mandakini River. So this is flowing from this direction to my pointing finger direction. So if we stand here to keep our face towards the moving direction, so our left is always known as the left bank and our right is always represent the right bank of the river. So this is the method how we can identify and how we can demonstrate the left bank and right bank of the river in the field. Okay, so I think this is enough for the virtual field and a unique field trip I have covered here, because before this I have lots of field trips and guided lots of university students, but this one is the first one to carry out the field work by using the technology, and it's good because in pandemic we can use it and we can learn. Okay, you can ask. Or any other thing I can explain, because maybe something I'm kept during this session. So if you have anything in your mind, how we can collect the different field, so you can ask. I can do the exercise because right now I'm in field, so I can do for you if you want other than this.
Anyone has any question?
Okay, I think I have explained very badly, that's why you don't have any question. Or I have explained nicely, that's why you don't have any question. So whatever, I think this is for this virtual field workshop, and I am concluding this session. If you have anything, you can ask right now.
Anyone having doubt? Okay, we have a doubt over here by Dhoti Patel. I am unmuting you.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, Dhoti.
Thank you so much. I wanted to thank you for this great virtual.
Okay, I think this is enough.
Hello.
Sir,
I wanted to thank you for this great virtual field trip. Sir, also, like, I'm in the fourth year, and I have gone to the field twice. I was lucky to go to the field twice from our university itself. So, sir, there are many juniors who are eagerly waiting to go to the field. If in the future, after there is no corona, can we organize a physical field trip with the institution that we're currently working with?
Hello, are we audible, sir?
Maybe sir is facing connectivity issue.
Yes.
Hello,
are you audible, sir? You are muted, sir. Hello.
Yes, Himanshu, you are audible to us, but sir might be facing some kind of network issue.
Sir, mic is off. He is muted. Hello. Your mic. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are audible now. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes, please. What was the question?
Sir, it was not a question. It was a thank you for this beautiful field trip on a Sunday morning. And sir, it was a request that after Corona, like if you can have a physical field trip with your institution.
Yeah, sure. Anytime you can join us after pandemic, so there is no problem. I am always available. There is no issue. And thank you. आप लोगों ने मुझे opportunity दिया ये सब contact करने के लिए. Thank you very much.
No sir, thanks to you sir. Thank you Mohit sir for such an informative session. Heartiest thank you to you and your whole team. As being a weekend, you went to the field and you share such concepts with us.
I am seeing hello, one more hello. Structure. Can I show you?
Yes, sir. Sure.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I have one more structure. Recently, I saw this. So here, I have one more. It's very interesting structure. You can see. So you can see we have some quartz vein here, and these are intersected by these quartz vein. So such type of structures are known as the flanking structure. So flanking fold and flanking fold, there is a controversy. And this flanking structure can be used to determine the shear sense direction as well as the tectonic setup of the area. So because here, this displacement, you can see, there is a displacement with respect to this vein and with respect to this vein. So this is displaced due to the intrusion of this vein. So this is a terminating element and this is the host element. So such type of structure known as the flanking structure. So this was the last structure I want to show you. Okay, now up.
Hello sir, I have one question.
Yeah, please.
Yes, sir. So when we encounter a fault, we can see that there is a footwall and a hanging wall. But how can we recognize when we see it? Can you please explain me?
Yeah, sure. Actually, previously I have explained. I'll explain to you. There is no problem. Yeah. You can see here we have a fault plane. This is our fault. Okay. So here what happened? This is the inclination of this plane. So again, what you have to use, you have to apply same methodology like we used to calculate the dip direction of the foliation plane and the joint plane. You can pour your dry soil or water over this plane. It will move towards this direction. So this is your dipping direction toward this direction. And now what you want to know, this is your question, how we can identify this is a footwall and this is a hanging wall. So this is your inclination towards this direction. This block is moving towards the downward side. So this one, this is in towards the inclination direction, we have a hanging wall. And towards, opposite towards the inclination direction, we have a foot wall. This is our foot wall. So this is the technical method how we can identify the hanging wall and the foot wall. If you want to use the traditional method, you try to try to stand over this fault plane. Try to stand yourself over this fault plane in imagination. So what happened? Your foot towards will be towards this direction. So it will be your foot wall. And your head towards this direction. So here we have a one wall, this one. So this is your hanging wall. This is the traditional method. Okay. So I think this is clear to you right now. If not clear, please let me know. Hello.
Yes, sir. It's clear. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Welcome.
Heartiest thank you to you and your whole team, sir. As being a weekend, you went to the field and you shared such concepts with us. Without you, it was difficult for us to conduct such event. And here I would like to add one thing. Dr. Mohit Kumar Punya has also had his YouTube channel named Dr. Mohit Kumar Punya. You can visit there for more such geological related video clips. Now, I think we are at the end of our session. Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah. Welcome to all of you, and thank you very much to give me this opportunity. Thank you. God bless you all.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much
for your contribution, your time.